The song was Two Tickets to Paradise. The year was 1978. Wow. I'm Eddie Money, and these are the sounds of the time.
In 1968, Edward Joseph Mahoney was a young officer in the New York City Police Force who turned in his badge when he was invited to join a West Coast band.
I couldn't really see myself in uniform for 20 years of my life with short hair, so I quit the police department, moved out to California. The band didn't really happen, and then I got a couple other bands, started writing a lot of material. I was living on Chef Boyardee ravioli and white bread because I left my parents and I quit the police department. I ran out of money, so it was a struggle for me. And I used to go to a lot of clubs and check out, you know, people like Etta James and Johnny Hooker and Buddy Guy and people like that. And I really learned a lot from watching them.
In 1976, after 8 years of touring, Eddie Mahoney changed his name to better reflect the times he was living in.
It was the disco era, money, 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 things like that.
The newly christened Eddie Money was discovered by legendary Columbia Records executive, Bill Graham.
All my work paid off when I got my deal with Columbia. And then I went on Saturday Night Live, got to meet Gilda Radner and John Belushi. As a matter of fact, I turned John Belushi onto the bungalow that he died in at the Chateau Marmont. Not intentionally, of course, because he was into a lot of heavy stuff that I wasn't into.
Money found himself thrust into the Manhattan music scene and honed his performing skills accordingly.
If you're a lead singer in New York, you're more than a lead singer. You've got to get out there, you've got to really dance and spin tambourines and really take the job very seriously.
But the disco culture of late 70s New York was a challenge for Money's blues rock persona.
I used to go to Studio 54, but I thought that was kind of really not my cup of tea. With ladies in the men's room and men's in the ladies' room, it wasn't like, you know, it was just too well for me. But one thing about disco, like I said, when you're in those clubs and you're doing all those formula hits with two verses and a chorus and a bridge and then a curse and a verse, the formula teaches you how to write.
With his sharpened songwriting skills, Money scored his first top 40 hit, but it wasn't the one he expected.
We were all Two Tickets to Paradise, and according to CHR Radio, Current Hit Rotation Radio, it wasn't commercial enough. So Jimmy Lyon and myself, we came up with Baby Hold On, and we wrote it about 3 days because it had a breakdown in it. It had a really good bridge in it, and like they say, it represented the American male inadequacies. Baby Hold On to me, wow, wow, wow. Baby Hold On was a huge hit for me. I mean, it got over 5 million spins. It's a lot of spins.
The success of Baby Hold On convinced the label to finally release Two Tickets to Paradise, which immediately rocketed into the top 40.
It was actually about a girl that I was dating. She was in UC Berkeley in a really ritzy sorority. And I was driving a 63 Studebaker and trying to make a living, you know, singing in clubs and stuff like that. And I really wanted to take her someplace on a vacation, but I couldn't take her to Aruba, I couldn't take her to Hawaii, or anything else like that. There's a place up in Northern California where all those big, beautiful redwoods are. And I wanted to go up there and have her see the redwoods. So to me, Two Tickets to Paradise was just actually a Greyhound bus trip that we never got to make.
The song hit number 22 on the Billboard Hot 100, solidifying Eddie Money's arrival as a major rock and roll talent. No longer a bad boy, he's still performing today, and his fans are still with him.
I have a generation of fans out there that couldn't really come to my shows for 20 years because they were raising kids, but now they're back with their kids, and the kids know all my music because it was in their parents' tape decks in the car.